Welcome back. Now we'll see the part 2 of the discussion. In this discussion, we will talk about CAPM model, capital asset pricing model. So till this point, you learned about your securities valuation, as in the standard deviation and the returns, return and standard deviation. So you all know how to find out the standard return and standard deviation. For standard deviation, you can use the TIBA 2 plus calculator, right? For return is simple, Rn minus Rn minus 1 divided by Rn minus 1. That is today's price, tomorrow's price, that comparison. So say, let's take one example, like 1 month before the price of stock was 90 and today the price is say 100. So your return is 100 minus 90 divided by 100. You can name it anything, like say Pn minus 1 divided by Pn minus 1. Simple. The meaning is important. So it is easy to calculate. Return can be calculated very easily. Standard deviation can be calculated easily using the your TIB2 plus calculator. That is standard deviation. Simple. Then we saw using these securities how to build a portfolio. So you selected three securities A, B, C. What should be their weights, respective weights? And then you will combine it in the portfolio, and based on this you will calculate the return, and then you will calculate the standard deviation. This will be standard deviation of the portfolio and return of the portfolio. For return of the portfolio, simply we do the weighted average. Simple. Weight return plus weight return plus weight return, that is return of the respective security. For standard deviation, we use the typical formula, which is under root of sigma 1 w1 square plus sigma 2 w2 square, sigma 1 w1 square plus sigma 2 w2 square plus, and so on. I'm not intentionally repeating the formula because the formula is a bit confusing. If you don't have practice of that formula, it is a bit difficult to remember. Okay, and you don't need it for the exam. Still remember for the two step formula, not more than two steps. Now we will see, when you are taking a decision of investing in a particular stock, say stock A, what should be your required return or the expected return? That is a return you expect to generate from that security. You want to find out expected return. For this particular part, we use CAPM, capital asset pricing model. Okay, that is a pricing model. See the word pricing, as in I will derive my expectation from that, this model. So first of all, we need to see some assumptions of the CAPM. Assumptions of capital asset pricing model. We'll start with the assumption. You have to remember assumptions in these words only. If you come from the 2019 syllabus and you are sitting for the 2020, then please check or make sure that the wordings of the meaning is exactly same. You saw same assumptions there in 2019 and here, but make sure you remember meaning, wordings with the meaning. Okay, so first is the free flow of information. That is, all investors will get information freely, and everyone who is willing investor can get the information on the particular stock to take the decision on the investment. Very simple. This is very important, free flow of information. If you are not provided with the specific informations, then you are not likely to take the similar decisions. Then frictionless markets. Meaning no taxes or commission on trades. This is required to ease out the calculation. You can still accommodate the taxes and the commission after working your calculation. Okay, not before working your calculation. But because CAPM assumes this, you have to work without taxation and commission calculation. Then fractional investment possible. Fractional investment as in, if you want to buy 0.5 shares, you can. In reality, you can't. But in theory, you have to assume this. Reason is very simple. Say you have $1 and you want to invest this $1 in three securities, and you can only buy 0.25 of one security, say A, then you can buy 0.25 security of B and you can buy 0.5 security of C, and the respective prices of the securities are $1. $1 is for every security. Okay, now you have only $1 in your pocket and you want to invest in these three securities in this proportion, like 25% in one, 25% in second, and 50% in third. So this is the only option. You have to go for the fraction, at least in the calculation. In reality, of course, you are not going to buy securities with $1, right? In reality, definitely not all the securities will be priced at the same range. But again, the problem will arrive. Problem will arrive when, say, you get, because in portfolio management, you will get the number like you have to invest 23.56% in security A, and say 23.56% of security A comes to say $1,000 and 1,002.56. So you want to write down this particular value for your calculation purpose, at least in theory. In real life, when you get this value, you will adjust it on the higher or the lower side. Okay, it is possible, but at least for the calculation purpose, you can, we don't have margin to round up or round down, right? For this reason, we assume that if you want to buy fractional amount, it is possible. Then we have next, perfect competition. This means that price takers investor, not price maker investor. That is, you cannot decide the price, you cannot influence the market, you can only take the price. So price taker investors, or investors in formal language, if I have to say the same thing, the investors are price takers and not the price makers. Just for the memory purpose, I wrote it in this manner: the price taker investors and not price makers. The next is the can borrow and lend at risk-free rate. Again, which is important, you need to borrow and invest at a risk-free rate. If you are not able to do this, then of course the problem will be, if you don't have funds, you cannot take the decision. If you want to invest in some security and say securities are not available, then definitely there will be a problem. So can borrow and lend at a risk-free rate is an important decision. I will explain you how all these assumptions fits in our equation, and homogeneous expectation. This is very important. Homogeneous expectation is that particular rule which makes sure the prices of the security are in particular order, because everyone should be expecting a similar type of return for a similar type of risk. So if you say if you want to take one unit of risk, for this one unit of risk you will want one unit of return. Okay, so if one investor is looking for this, then every investor should be looking for the same thing. For every one unit of risk, he should be asking for one unit of return. So one unit means not one percentage and one percentage like this. One unit can be anything. One unit can be, say, one for like 2% of risk, investor is asking for 3% of return, like this. Okay, if you don't assume this, then the problem is your CAPM holds like no value, because everyone will take their own decision even after seeing the expected return from CAPM, right? Now, what is the CAPM equation? CAPM equation is very simple and intuitive to understand. CAPM, capital asset pricing model. Equation goes like, expected return on this security. Expected as in what you expect the security to generate. Okay. Expectation. So, you know, like we have expectation from someone. I have to explain this word specifically, expectation, for very important reason, because after this we have required return. okay, and both these words are used interchangeably in by different authors. So some author call CAPM's return as a required return, some author calls it as a expected return. Okay, so even if we interchange it, you need to remember that what is the meaning of this. In exam, the possibilities, GAF will give you expected return as per CAPM, and maybe for required return, GARP will say as per analyst valuation. Totally possible. As per CAPM, as per analyst valuation. Expected return and required return. And you have to learn to use it interchangeably. But what is the meaning here? Meaning is, we have some expectations from anyone, like from anything, from say your boss, your employees, or your colleagues and family, like this. So that expectation word we are using here. So we have some expectation from this particular security, and the expectation of return. So a particular security's return is, it should give me risk-free return first, and plus RM minus RF into beta. So what is RF? RF is risk free rate, RM is market return, RF is again of course, and beta is beta. Simple. What is the market return? Market return is expected return of market. So in book the words are written like the EE and so on. I'm not following the same convention. You have to just remember, like, both have the same meaning. That is return you expect from the market. Say you expect return from the market as 10% return, and risk-free rate is 5%. Okay, so 5% if you invest in the risk-free security, if you invest in the market, then the return is 10%. The difference of these two, that is 10% minus 5%, is known as market risk premium. What is this market risk premium? Market risk premium is a premium you will earn for investing in the market. If you want to invest in the market, this is the premium you earn. Okay, here we are talking about investment in security, not in the market. But as we know that once you diversify the portfolio, only risk left is the risk related to the beta. Beta as in the market related risk. So if market goes up, what will happen to security? Like this. Now let's see the first illustration, which is a simple illustration. Say I want to invest in a security which is government security. Government securities are free from market movement because these are backed by the government. Free from market movement. So what should be your required rate of return or expected rate of return? That is expectation as per CAPM. So you will ask for RF, of course. RF is always asked, because if you do nothing and simply invest in the RF, you will be able to produce return RF, right? So you will produce RF always, right? So that's why you will ask for the RF on the security, plus RM minus RF. So here we'll take example of same 5% plus 10% minus 5% multiplied by another question is beta. Remember this, because government securities are not influenced by the market, the beta of the government security will be zero, because it cannot influence, there is no influence in it on it. So beta is equal to zero. If the beta is equal to zero, we will put zero here. So your expectation from a government security will be equal to RF, because this complete term will be zero. So RF. Now let's interpret it. Because you are not taking any risk related to the market, you should not expect anything in return for that risk. Okay, so you are not getting anything in return. So if you take risk, you will get return. If you don't take risk, that is in the CAPM equation, it is a market related risk. If you don't take risk, you will not get any return. So that's why expected return on the government security is nothing but the risk-free rate. And you can cross-check this with the real life example. So you will find risk-free security and treasury bonds and all those returns are similar. Okay, not exactly same, but similar. So reason is this. That is, you are not taking any risk related to the market. Now, what if you want to invest 100% amount in the market only? See, this equation is balanced so beautifully that even if you just randomly place your values, you will get a right answer, which is a meaningful answer. I will show you how. So now see, if you want to invest in market, so what happens here? Beta of market is equal to 1. Why? Because it is beta itself is a relationship of stock with the market. So if you want to find out the relationship of market, which it will be always 1. So beta of stock market is equal to 1 always. You have to remember this. Then expected return is equal to, again, in case you find that the same thing ERI is written as a required rate of return in the book, doesn't matter. Expected and required rate are replaceable. Only thing is, expected return as per CAPM, required rate of as per CAPM means both. Expected return as per analyst valuation, required rate of return as per analyst valuation means the same thing. Okay, both means the same thing. Now, again, the same formula, RF plus RM minus RF. I'm going to write this formula for at least like 10-15 times. You don't even have to remember this. You will automatically remember it. Now, what is your RF? 5% plus what is your RM minus RF? Simply tell, RM minus RF is 10 minus 5 multiplied by beta is 1. Answer is 10. Without even solving, I know the answer is 10. Now, why answer is 10? Again, interpretation. Interpretation is, because you are investing your whole money in market, you should expect return equal to market. Very simple. So that's why you are getting return which is equal to market, 10%. So you invested your whole money in the market. Beta of the market is 1. Beta of market with market is 1. That's it. Simple calculation. Even if I give you like normal example, even if I would have asked you like in oral exam, like tell me, without even doing any calculation, you could have told me like 10% is the expected return from the market, because market return itself is a market's expected return is 10%. So according to CAPM, it should be 10%. Now, what if you invest in a security? Now I will take the three examples and we will do the direct calculation. Okay. So beta of 0.5, beta of 1.5 and beta of 2. So these are the three examples. So let's see answer. So here answer will be 5 plus 10 minus 5 is 5 multiplied by 0.5. Answer is 0.25, which is 7.5. You can do the calculation. 5 plus 5, 5 multiplied by 0.5 is it 2.5. Sorry. 0.25, 0.25 plus 5 is the 7.5. So if the beta is 0.5, that is your security is not as risky as market. So you are investing in the safer security. So of course your return will be lower than the market, because you are investing in a security which is lower, which is safer than the market. Okay. So see here. Then second is 1.5. So you are investing in a security whose beta is 1.5, meaning it is 1.5 times riskier than the market. So you should get paid 1.5 times whatever is the risk premium you are taking. Then again 0.5 minus 5 and it is 1.5. So 5 into 1.5 is the 7.5. 7.5 plus 5 is the 12.5. Answer is 12.5. If I make any arithmetic mistake, don't worry, you do your calculation. Ultimate conclusion is important. Okay. So conclusion is, because you are investing in a security which is riskier than the market, you are getting paid higher compared to market risk premium. And the next is 2, beta of 2. 5 plus 10 minus 5 multiplied by 2, that is 5, 5, 2, 15. So you should get 15% return. So your expectation from this particular stock whose beta is 2, which is twice as risky as market, you should get paid 15%. It is not like directly double, okay? Not in the in this particular format, like you can simply double it. You have to use the CAPM equation. In CAPM, whatever is the market risk premium, as in whatever is the extra risk you are taking compared to risk-free security. Because in this, you can see, first of all, like 5% of this 15% is itself a return paid to you according to risk-free rate. And remaining is 10%. In this 10%, because you are choosing market risk, because you are choosing market security, okay, which is more riskier. So first of all, you should get paid that amount, that is a 5% of investing, 5% extra of investing in the market, which is this particular part. Okay, so here you have 5%. 5% is for taking risk in the market. And remaining 5% is because you are taking double risk. So you are getting paid double. For double risk, you are getting paid double. So this is how this equation works. So first 5% is paid for the risk-free security. Then 5% is paid for your taking risk in the market. Then 5% is paid for because you are taking double risk. So you should get paid double. If you divide this in the same manner here, so this calculation goes like, the first 5% is for the risk-free security, next 5% is for investing in the market, that is, this is for the RF, this is for RM minus RF, and then this is because you are taking 0.5 times extra, 0.5 times extra risk, you should get paid 0.5 times extra return, which is 2.5, 0.5 of this 5% extra risk of the market is 2.5, like this. Okay, and same is applicable here. Beta can be negative, so always remember, if the beta is negative, the calculation will go in that manner, like it will work in the negative, it will go in the negative direction. Okay. The formula for the beta is correlation of xm, x is for the security, m is for the market, multiplied by sigma x upon sigma m. Always remember this. So correlation multiplied by your sigma x, which is standard deviation of security, divided by standard deviation of market. Now you remember formula for correlation, covariance of x y divided by sigma x sigma y, right? So if you replace this particular formula here, you will get covariance of x y divided by sigma x sigma y for correlation, and then sigma x multiplied by sigma x divided by sigma m. By mistake I took y, so it should be m, sigma m. Now see here, sigma x cancel, answer goes to covariance of x y divided by sigma m square. So this is your second formula. The first formula is this, second formula is this. First formula, just close your eyes and listen to my voice. So if you find it difficult, you will be able to remember it. So beta is equal to sigma xm, sorry, just a second. Beta of security, beta of x is equal to correlation of xm multiplied by sigma x divided by sigma m. So correlation xm multiplied by sigma x divided by sigma m. I will repeat third time, so it will stuck in your mind. Beta is equal to correlation xm multiplied by sigma x divided by sigma m. This is the one formula. Second formula is beta of x is equal to covariance of xy divided by sigma m square. Remember this, covariance of xy divided by sigma m square. Okay, I hope you got the idea, and I hope you remember this particular formula. And we saw some illustration. I will just give you the quick illustration for your practice. Illustration, say number one, calculate the required rate of return. Calculate required rate of return for stock एपी इनकॉर्पोरेशन हुज एक्सपेक्टेड रिटर्न ऑन द मार्केट इज 12%, RF is equal to 6%, risk free rate security is 6%, beta of this particular stock is 1.2. You will take example 1.45 and then 2. Okay, just do the calculation. All these are simple calculations. You can put the value and get the answer. And here we are saying required rate of return. Required rate of return according to CAPM. And if you are not provided with the beta, then you have to do your own calculation. You have to calculate it. Here we provided you the beta. I provided you the beta. Okay. If I give the information relating to the sigma x say 10%, sigma m say 12%, and then correlation of x m say 0.30, then you have to work out the beta. How you will do it? So 0.3030 multiplied by 0.10 divided by 0.12, and whatever is the answer, you will get the beta, right? This is very simple calculation. Now, relationship of asset excess return, that is RI minus RF. So this is asset excess return. And market excess return. This is market excess return. So what is the meaning of this asset excess return, market excess return? So excess return produced on the security, that is asset excess return compared to the risk free security, and market excess return is the return produced on the market compared to your risk-free security. So you will get line like this. Always remember in exam if you get this particular line, and your securities will fall in certain manner, this particular manner, and this is your beta. Okay, so you can find out beta using this particular return. So relationship of RI minus RF and RM minus RF will give you beta. You remember equation? RF plus RM minus RF multiplied by beta. So beta decides return of the asset. Okay. And if I solve this particular question, so which is RI is equal to, I'll just write it formally. RI. So I can switch the sides. So see here, RI minus RF is equal to RM minus RF into beta. So beta is the player here. So beta is deciding what happens with these two. And again, if we adjust it, so this can be RI minus RF divided by RM minus RF is equal to beta, right? So very simple to understand, nothing special. So the relationship of, this is a point, theoretical point you are supposed to remember for exam. That the relationship is like this, that is asset excess return and market excess returns relationship is the beta. I guess you have same question in our mock. Security market line. Now, what is security market line? You remember capital market line? Please remember the differences between the capital market line and the security market line. This is testable, highly testable question. Okay. Expected return here and beta on this side. So with the increasing beta, what happens to the expected return? This particular line, the line which gives you the relationship between the beta and the expected return of security is known as the security market line, SML. So this is your zero beta, this is beta is equal to 1 and then beta beta, like simple, whatever is the above. Then you have expected return in the market. Now see here, if you have beta is equal to 0, then the return produced is RF, this particular point. If you combine this point and this particular point, so this return, okay, at this point what is your beta? Beta is 1. So what should be the return? Return should be RM, return on the market. Very simple, because beta is 1. For the respective beta of 1, you should earn market risk, risk return of market, okay, market return. And this difference of RF minus RM minus RF is the market risk premium. Again, remember this, market risk premium is the difference between the RM minus RF, is the difference between the RM minus RF, and risk premium, market return is RM. This is RM. Right now you will feel like you understood the thing. In exam, most of the students end up making this mistake. So GAAP gives you market risk premium, say 10%, RF is say 5%. What they do? They do is 5 plus RM minus RF. So they take 10 minus 5 multiplied by beta. Say beta is 1.2. And your whole answer is wrong. Why? Because you should have taken 5 plus 10 multiplied by 1.2, because this 10 is market risk premium. This is already RM minus RF. Okay. And based on this, what will be your market return? Market return is 10 plus 5 is equal to 15% is your market return. So if GAAP gives you market return, this will be 15%. If GAAP gives you market risk premium, it will be 10%, just for the example. Now, this particular line is security market line. This is your RM, that is return of the portfolio, required rate of return from the market. And this is for the market portfolio. Okay. Now, what is the slope? Slope is equal to, so slope of market risk premium is equal to RM minus RF divided by, that is 1 minus 0, 1 is for the, that is beta beta, okay. So RM minus RF, what is this calc, what is this? Just try to guess. If you are able to guess, really good. The solution is, see, what are we doing here? Slope is always the difference between the x-axis, that is change in the x-axis versus change in the y-axis, right? Change in x-axis, change in y-axis. Change in y divided by change in x-axis. So here for y-axis you have RM minus RF. So this is your RM minus RF, and to get the RM minus RF, your beta moves from 0 to 1. So for this point you get RF, for 0 you get RF, and for 1 beta you get RM. So total distance, simply whatever is the answer, is your slope. The RM minus RF is slope here. So you need to remember slope of SML, security market line. How to remember that security market line is about CAPM and capital market line is about your capital distribution for lending and borrowing portfolio. So remember the word capital. Capital as in how you want to invest your capital. You want to borrow capital, you want to lend capital, you don't want to do anything with the capital and simply invest in the market, is the capital market line. So if you remember like this, capital market line talks about the capital, about that line, And the second is the security market line. Security market line is talks about a specific security. And we know CAPM is used for what? Securities required rate of return calculation. So you can relate like this. So SML is for the securities required rate of return calculation. That's why it is a security market line. Slope of the security market line is RM minus RF. Very simple. I hope you got the idea. Okay, now again we will take break, and after this we will start the application of CAPM. Very easy section, very important section. Expect at least 2 questions and 40 minute discussion, not more than this. So we'll take a break and we'll resume. So please remember, read whatever is written in your book after this, like whatever is here I wrote after this. Whatever is this CAPM section, this particular section, just read it before you watch the next video.